Rob, welcome to Video Masters TV. Come in through the window. That's my handwriting. I even had it underlined. Stupid! 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 Why am I so stupid? Stupid! Ow. Oh, man up. How's your head?
Did I play the violin?
Not that I'm aware of. So good. We'll just leave it at no. Oh, hey. Guys, welcome to the February 2012 episode of Video Masters TV. My name is John. And today marks the 17th anniversary of Video Masters. Now, to clear up any confusion, we haven't been on the internet for 17 years. We've existed for 17 years. Now, we spent 6 years online, so maybe that's where the confusion lies. So, I just wanted you internet dwellers out there to get your facts straight so you guys don't think we ripped off the angry video game nerd by going forward into time and ripping him off in the future from 1995.
Great Scott!
1995! Oh, guys, this is Rob, our newest member to the VMTV family.
Hey.
So, Rob, what can you bring to the table here at Video Masters TV?
Well, John, I'm a geek.
We all are.
A nerd. A spaz, if you will. And the question of what can I bring to Video Masters TV? Well, John, let's set the Wayback Machine to the 1970s and the 1980s when I grew up. I was a geek when it really wasn't fashionable. Yeah, I mean, my love wasn't for school or sports or even my fellow man. It was for things like movies, comic books, Marvel, DC, Commodore 64, Atari, ColecoVision, and I would take great joy in being familiar with those friends of mine and in my parents' basement, enjoy them along with a sleeve of Devil Dogs and a bag of corn chips.
It's a way to go.
I have a vast experience and knowledge in pretty much all things that are movies, TV, and video games, and I think that is our mission. It is our job. And for the last 17 years, it has been your job to relentlessly, doggedly, and truthfully, along with a bit of a sense of humor, break down the truth and deliver it to you, the viewing public. Because that's what you deserve. We will shine like never before, like a 1080p beacon of hope, from sea to shining sea over smartphones and laptops and computer consoles and conventions. And we will continue to make it our mission to educate, to reintroduce, and to bring the very essence of this multi-billion dollar industry that courses through our veins, because for 17 years, John, six online, it is a grand and glorious tradition that only the bold, the foolhardy, and the brave can attempt to bring forth. Somebody has to do it, John, and that somebody is us.
I promised myself I wouldn't do this.
It's okay, buddy.
Ooh, and crumb cake.
Oh.
I brought crumb cake.
Well, not too many hosts can bring all that and crumb cake. So, on behalf of all of us here at Video Masters TV, all the hosts from around the world, we welcome you to the show, and we welcome your crumb cake as well.
Thank you.
You guys get to see Rob's review a little later on in the show, so be sure to tune in for that. So, as you can see, we got a great show lined up for you guys. What do you say we get things started the old-fashioned way by seeing what's on the cheat sheet?
I made this myself.
And that's why it says Entman's on it.
Don't you judge me.
If you played Ghosts and Goblins on the NES, or any other system for that matter, you know that it can get insanely tough to complete. Well, with the NES version fired up, I thought I'd share a stage select tip that may help you out. At the title screen, hold right on controller 1 and press button B 3 times. Now release right, then press up and button B 3 times, left and button B 3 times, and finally down and button B 3 times. After you press start, a stage select screen will now appear. Just press A or B to select where you'd like to begin. Alright, so once again, at the title screen, hold right on controller 1 and press button B 3 times, then release right and press up and button B 3 times, left and button B 3 times, and then down and button B 3 times. After you press start, a stage select screen will appear. Now just press A or B to select where you'd like to start your level. Let's continue the spookiness today with Ghouls and Ghosts for the Sega Genesis. We'll save stage selects for another time. Let's try something different, gamers. How about invincibility? Well, here's how to get it. At the title screen, press button A 4 times, then press up, down, left, and right on the directional pad. You'll hear a chime indicating you did the trick right. While you're playing a regular game, pause the action, then press button A and press start again, and you will be invincible. Now, this won't save you from falls and every single danger, but it should make traveling through these levels easier on you. Alright, let's take a look at that one more time, okay? At the title screen, press button A 4 times, and then press up, down, left, and right. Once you hear the chime, you did the trick correctly. While you're playing a regular game, press start to pause, then press button A and unpause the game, and you'll be invincible. Alright guys, here we are about to dive right into some hot and spicy zombie action.
Wait, what? John, we're not reviewing zombie porn.
Well...
Although...
Delete.
No, that's something I don't even think Sam Raimi would touch.
Not in a million years.
But what a clever segue.
Yes, indeed.
Deadites. Zombies. The undead. No matter how you name them, those rotting meatbags of flesh brain-eating crazies have forever ingrained themselves into popular culture. And we, the living, love to find all sorts of creative and sinister ways to chop, eviscerate, decapitate, and mash the undead. And then lovingly capture the carnage on film.
Not an easy thing to do.
Before director Sam Raimi directed the blockbuster Spider-Man and showed us his dramatic Oscar-y side in A Simple Plan, and even gave us the dermatologically challenged cranky pants Darkman when the studio would not let him direct The Shadow, believe it or not. He gave the zombie genre an old whack with his directorial breakthrough, The Evil Dead. Reviewed, coincidentally, by Matt and Brian, Season 2, Video Masters.
We miss you guys.
This is a chop-em-up, gooey, undead fright fest with a bunch of kids off on a weekend getaway, with the exception of one groovy hero. He doesn't get taken over by the undead, but they do. And he systematically mangles, chops up, and kills every single one of them into pieces. Our said hero's name? Ash. Now, Sam Raimi directed a short film called Within the Woods. Now, Evil Dead was a redo of this film. And this short film needed another redo, apparently, because the Evil Dead, after achieving some midnight movie cult status, they decided that with a little bit bigger of a budget from the studios, they would make a sequel called Evil Dead 2, Dead by Dawn, the subject of today's review.
The year was 1987. Director Sam Raimi and his producer, Rob Tappert, along with their star, the generously chinned Bruce Campbell, return, hell-bent on bringing us more blood, gore, and splatter, along with a copious amount of slapsticky laughs. Bruce Campbell once again plays Ash, not only the hardcore sole survivor of the first installment, but the total knuckle-headed lame brain that takes another vacation back to the eerily familiar spot in the woods. Driving the same Oldsmobile Delta 88 that stars in almost every Raimi project, in practically the same abandoned domicile where the gruesome brouhaha happened the first time! I mean, what gives, dumbass? There are some who postulate that since Raimi and Tappert had a bigger budget, they decided to auspiciously film a remake. This could even be considered a second remake of the film Within the Woods. As the funding got larger and the ideas and effects got bigger and better, including a remake of a very disturbing scene between a girl and some naughty, incorrigible, evil trees, sporting, you guessed it, wood. But we don't want to spoil it for you. As opposed to picking up where the first film left off, Evil Dead 2 begins with some cool imaging and animation backed by a dulcet baritone professor, spinning us an expositional tale of an archaeological expedition, with his tag-along wife, Henrietta, his cargo short pants daughter, and her white-bred, blonde, blue-eyed, ancillary character boyfriend and doctor's assistant, Ed, whom we're happy to see get chopped to bits later. I mean, look at him. I'm a pacifist, and even I want to hack him to death with an axe. Looks like the brainless douchebag used to give me wedgies in gym class. Anyway, on their expedition, they discover the Necronomicon Ex Mortis, the Book of the Dead. Professor Archaeologist McShould have known better recites the passages out loud into a reel-to-reel recorder in his remote cabin in the woods with his needle-pointing wife, and unleashes the evil only to then disappear without any explanation. Or evil. Now things are going to start to get fun. A new, fresh hell is about to break loose quicker than a Vietnamese prostitute leaving Salt Lake City. So, the rest of this review will thusly follow that theme in double time. Are you ready? Here we go. Linda gets possessed, tries to kill Ash. Ash knocks off Linda's head with a shovel and buries her body, but forgets to bury her head, and why bother? She's dead, and it flew off. The head and Ash get into a head-bangingly hilarious melee, and Ash wants to take a chainsaw to his girlfriend's head. Now Ash has completely lost all sense of reality, gets chased around by a ground motion camera, is summarily possessed, and turns back into human form in the daylight, only to be tormented into a paranoid rage, cutting off his now possessed hand, then laughs a whole bunch, and then almost shoots the real owners of the cabin, Dr. Daughter, Ed, and the hillbilly travel guides. They then kick the crap out of Ash and toss him into the salad to rot with some fruit. Oh, and the professor's buried wife, Henrietta. A bunch of other undead stuff starts to happen. More possession, a sea of red blood, spattering of yucky green blood, a flying eyeball on a stick, Henrietta emerging from the fruit cellar, which is actually Sam Raimi's actor brother Ted, in an uncomfortable zombie-looking grandma suit. Paying them dues, huh, Ted? Oh, yeah. Ash continues to kick some ass with his axe, chainsaw, and shotgun, or boomstick, and wages battle with the zombie horde as they creepily assure the living they'll be dead by dawn.
Groovy.
But while Ash still is ass-kicking, the daughter figures out what her dad couldn't, recites the passages to open the time portal, and flush the evil down the old universal toilet. She gets killed anyway by one of the relics in Ash's possessed hand he chopped off earlier. And when you think about it, Ash has been directly responsible for killing almost every character in Evil Dead and Evil Dead 2. Hero or homicidal maniac? Ash's hair turns white at the sight of the hideous creature in the space potty looking to eat him, and retaliates by giving it a bad case of stick-a-knife-in-the-eye disease. The vortex is just too powerful for Ash as he gets flushed into space, lands smack dab in the past or future, and with no way to get back, although the old 88 will keep him company, leaving room for another movie. Now what? Is it another remake? A sequel? Why, yes it is. Ash does come back to smash some deadite skulls again in the movie Army of Darkness, which we'll tackle another time. Phew! Wow. I'm exhausted. Amidst all the banter and festoonery associated with my review, I personally love the campy feel, physical shtick, and uber gore that have all been neatly and psychotically packaged into this film. Raimi and his clubhouse of He-Man zombie haters not only know their material, but exploit every aspect successfully, with only a few holes and continuity errors. There's some cool puppetry and not-so-cool puppetry, eyeball on a stick, clever and not-so-clever effects, but when going into a cinematic enterprise with a limited budget, necessity becomes the mother of invention, and the cast and crew never lose their sense of irony in play when presenting it as seriously as they can, but giggling off-camera along the way. I remember as a teen being simultaneously repulsed, brought to hysterics, confused, anxious, and excited when I saw this film. It was so different from any other horror film I'd seen up to that point.
The raw feeling the original film Evil Dead gave us has been polished, rebuffed, given a sense of humor, and crafted into a squishy, nerve-jangling experience that shows a mad twinkle in the eye of Sam Raimi and his cast of characters, shows us the greatness that they're going to achieve later.
That was a great review, man. So, what'd you guys think? Do you want him to tackle Army of Darkness next? Maybe you got something in mind for him in the near future. Let him know. He's got his own email now. It's rob@videomasterstv.com. Drop him a line.
Wow. You gave me my own email address?
Yeah, sure.
Jeez. I didn't get you anything.
Well, you got me the crumb cake right there. The one you made yourself.
Yeah, I did, you know.
With your own blood, sweat, and tears.
Yeah.
Toiled many hours in a hot kitchen.
Hey, wait. What are you saying? Are you saying I didn't make that crumb cake? That in the Gristiti's on 34th Street, I ripped it off some crippled old lady with a walker because I figured she didn't need it? Well, what do you take me for anyway? Maybe she was asking for me to take that from her. Maybe I deserve that crumb cake. Is that what you're saying?
No! Alright guys, got a few great finds in the digital dig for this month. First up is a video featuring a Filipino He-Man. Yeah, this is no joke. Apparently, in 1985, He-Man was so popular that some folks in the Philippines decided to make their own version of the most powerful man in the universe. Now, I can sit here for several minutes and point out the weird parts and the dialogue, but go check it out for yourself later on. We'll link you up. Does anyone remember a Bobo from Double Dragon? You know, that big hulking dude. Well, apparently, someone put him in a Flash game. And guess what? It kicks serious ass. It's called A Bobo's Big Adventure, and this one was made with love, folks. You will see some familiar video game characters make appearances, and you'll encounter lots of cool surprises. Check our forums for a link to the official website where you can play this game. You won't be sorry. Speaking of classic stuff, this video is a combination of Star Wars and Magnum PI. The result? Han Solo P.I. All it is really is the theme song to Magnum P.I. mixed with scenes from the three Star Wars films. The good ones. It's actually edited perfectly. This is a quick one, but a good one. Go and check it out. This next one is a fan-made short done by the same guy who made the feature-length Mega Man film. We'll talk about that one another time. For now, let's focus on Chun-Li vs. Cammy. This is a neat little film to watch, though, since it's a little under 5 minutes, you'd kind of wish they'd cut back on the dialogue between the two fighters prior to the actual fight. At least we get some cool fighting sequences, as well as our friend, the angry video game nerd himself, James Rolfe, as the tournament announcer. Pretty cool, huh? I was kind of hesitant to feature this due to the fact that this website was affected heavily by SOPA just weeks ago. But this site deserves to be mentioned. This is RetroMags.com,
and it's got scanned pages of full video game magazines, like Nintendo Power, Game Pro, Electronic Gaming Monthly, and a few others like Turbo Force, Sega Visions, and even Edge Magazine from over in the UK. At present, 99% of the site's content is unavailable, because it was downloadable from MegaUpload.com, which was recently shut down. But RetroMags is slowly picking up the pieces, and new scanned magazine images are becoming available. Gang, show your support to these guys and pay a visit to www.retromags.com. That'll do it for this digital dig. Check our message boards at videomasterstv.com to links to all the material that was mentioned. Later.
And that's how I helped Sylvester Stallone start his own film career.
Wow, all that and you made him cake. What a guy.
That's just the kind of guy I am. So, Rob, are you a Mortal Kombat guy or a Street Fighter guy?
John, I like them both, but even though Street Fighter predeceased Mortal Kombat, I didn't enjoy the cartoony feel as much as the realism of Mortal Kombat and the cool characters and weapons that Mortal Kombat brought. So I'm a Mortal Kombat guy.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm a little bit of both, and both franchises are still going strong even today. So it begs the question, which game should I review this month? Mm-hmm. Mortal Kombat or Street Fighter 4? Both are for the Xbox 360 and PlayStation 3, but we got them both for the 360. So which one should I do? What do you think?
Can we do both?
That's not a bad idea. I like that. All right, here we go, guys.
Many of us have played a Street Fighter game in some form at some point in our lives. I most recently played the Super Nintendo Street Fighter 2 against some folks while I was at MAGFest earlier this year. And I'll be honest, I left the series after Street Fighter 2 Turbo. I didn't hang around for the Supers, the Alphas, or even the Versus games. So you might be saying I'm not qualified to review Street Fighter 4. Well, I'm doing it anyway. But don't worry, I actually like this one. Now, even though the backgrounds and models are 3D, you'll find that you're controlling your fighters on a 2D playing area. We'll talk about the graphics later on in the review. There's a couple of options to the game, including training and challenge modes, arcade play, online verse matches, and more. When I first started playing the game, my single player matches were constantly interrupted by someone online wanting to challenge me. Now, I tried a few online matches, but for the most part, I wanted to enjoy the single-player experience without some random Xbox Live match starting up while I'm winning. Or losing. Luckily, you're able to turn this feature off if you wish. Moving on, in addition to recurring characters like Zangief, E-Honda, Chun-Li, Guile, Ken, and Ryu, there's a few extra faces. Abel, Crimson Viper, El Fuerte, and Rufus. How can this 500-pound guy fight without having a heart attack? Who cares? It's a video game. Just go with it. There are more characters than what I've already mentioned, but you'll meet them all in good time. There are at least 19 characters total in this game, including this guy, Seth, who can mimic many of the fighters' special moves. When I first saw this dude, he kind of reminded me of that Granite Boob Lady from Virtua Fighter 5 Online. Remember that? Well, this game is chocked full of combos and attack moves. Focus attack can enable your fighter to absorb your opponent's attack and counterattack by hitting the medium kick and punch buttons at the same time. The ultra combos are long combination of kicks, punches, and other moves. Now, since I'm an average gamer, I'm lucky if I can perform half these moves. Sometimes, they'll happen by accident. I'm just happy if I can perform a Sonic Boom or Hadouken! It doesn't take much to make me happy. Street Fighter 4 is a game I found to be quite enjoyable. Even though I kind of suck sometimes at fighting games, I still kept trying to defeat some of the more difficult opponents. And believe me, there were some close calls where both my energy meter and my opponent's energy meter were down to nothing, and either I was defeated or the other guy. There were a lot of, aw man, moments for me, personally. When a special move is performed, the camera cuts to an awesome cinematic as you, or your opponent, unleash one hell of an ass-whooping. The graphics are beautifully hand-drawn, Even though you're fighting in 3D backgrounds, it wasn't intended for fighters like Guile, Blanca, or M. Bison to be photorealistic. I think this was a smart move, as I love the overall art style and the way the game is presented. Every fighter moves around fluidly. I haven't noticed any frame rate hiccups or slowdown. What's cool is that the game has anime-style cutscenes for each character. While I'm no huge anime fan like many of you are, I have to say these cinematic scenes are gorgeous. The music in each stage is great, the sound effects rock, and the game has some pretty good voiceovers, though, I don't know. Somehow I wasn't expecting Blanca to sound the way he does.
Jimmy!
Mama, what are you doing here?
Maybe I stand alone on that one, so let's get to control. Naturally, you have the option of moving around with either the directional pad or the analog stick, and you have a great assortment of kicks, punches, and special moves that have been a staple in the Street Fighter series since the very beginning. Now, I kept alternating between the pad and the stick. I noticed I do slightly better with the D-pad, and there are arcade sticks available if you want to have a more authentic arcade experience, since many Street Fighter fans were introduced to the series in their neighborhood arcade. Depending on your skill and experience with the series, you may breeze through this game in just a few hours or a few days. There are selectable difficulties, and as you're playing through the game with different fighters, you'll find which ones can get the job done, and which characters are just plain useless. Now, I know there's a Super Street Fighter 4 out there, as well as iOS and Android versions, and whether you're a PS3 owner or 360 owner, I think this game is totally worth the cash. And plus, you can probably get Street Fighter 2 at a pretty reasonable price at your local video game retailer. So, in conclusion, keep this one. Alright, the second half of our fighting game madness continues with Mortal Kombat, but not the original arcade or even the classic console versions. This one is playable on the PS3 and Xbox 360, and today we're playing the 360 version. Now, like Street Fighter 4, this Mortal Kombat, also known as Mortal Kombat 9, is a 2D fighting game with 3D graphics. Fans were eagerly awaiting this game, since most of them were disappointed with Mortal Kombat vs. DC Universe and its toned-down gore factor. The story involves Raiden trying to alter the present by sending a mental warning to himself in the past. All this right before Shao Kahn kills him. There's more to the story, which is basically a bit of a retelling of the first three Mortal Kombats, with some changes here and there. At least you get to play with many of the familiar MK characters like Johnny Cage, Sub-Zero, Scorpion, Liu Kang, Reptile, Melina, Kano, Kung Lao, and even Smoke. Aw, Smoke, what did they do to you? Alright, that's more like it. So, the game modes include standard modes, fatality training modes, tag team, online play, and challenge tower, which include 300 specific challenges, which, if completed, give you currency rewards. And besides test your might, there's also test your sight, test your luck, and test your strike. These will either require you to destroy blocks, follow an object underneath a cup, or not performing a certain move during a match. One other feature that I thought was incredibly cool was the X-ray move. Here, the camera gives you a view of your opponent's bones and organs as they break. It's a gruesome feature, but it's frickin' amazing. You'll love it. If the DC crossover title left you cold, this Mortal Kombat game will restore your faith in the series. With beautiful cutscenes, detailed graphics, and realistic damage and blood on the fighters, there's nothing bad I can say about the overall look of this game. The audio shines as well. The bones crunching, the rustling of clothes on the fighter, and ambient background sounds just give you an unbelievable experience that you'd have to play for yourself rather than just take my word for it. Voiceovers are plenty in this game, and they all seem to fit their respected characters from Johnny Cage to Raiden, Scorpion, and more. You'll also find the music tracks similar to previous MK installments, but they're completely new arrangements, and they're really good. Moving your fighters around and performing basic moves is not a problem. Ignore the fact that I can't pull off a special move or perform a fatality worth a fuck, and you should do just fine making the characters do what you command them to do, within reason. Guys, we still can't get the female characters to do exactly what we want, but don't worry. Maybe someday they'll release a Mortal Kombat Women's Mud Wrestling Competition. Or that will be an unlockable. Speaking of which, unlockables are abound as well. Those currency rewards that I mentioned earlier can be used to unlock goodies in the crypt. You can get alternate costumes, secret characters, and a whole lot more. I hate to ruin it all for you. If you know where to look, you'll obtain secrets that are worth something, as opposed to those which may end up being a waste of time and currency. I can safely say that this game is not a waste of either time or currency. Surely worth your hard-earned cash, whether you're engaged in the single-player storyline or a match with someone in the same room or online, this game has a lot to offer both newcomers and veterans to the Mortal Kombat series. This game is definitely a keeper, folks.
Alright, folks, thanks for joining us today on the February 2012 edition of Video Masters TV. You can watch previous episodes on videomasterstv.com.
And you can follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and see what we're up to on the message forum. We talk about everything, and it's free to join. So until next time, my name is John, this is Rob, and he makes his own crumb cake. Honest.
Actually, I didn't make the crumb cake.
No.
Yeah, I'm going to go return it to the old lady. She's probably got the diabetes and doesn't need it anyway, but, you know. And I think we'll be sued for copyright infringement by the Entenmann's Corporation, so I'll...
That's the kind of world we're living in right now.
I'll go and I'll see you in 5 to 10.
Or perhaps on the next episode. In any event, I guess we'll see you next time on the next episode of VMTV. Take it easy, you guys.
Come in through the window, huh? Come in through the window. Eat it. Eat the crumb cake.
Oh, no,
you
no.
Bastard.
No.
By the power of great stone. I am the power.